It's a new day, and I need to really get myself to resume, kind of hitting a point where I kind of stalled. So let's see the enforcing mode. I hope I'm not. Yeah, I'm probably still in permissive mode. So I've been running this system for a day in permissive mode. Get enforce. Yeah, damn. But okay, it's a virtual machine. So I'm still in permissive mode. Let's just unload the don't audit rules, because we now at a point we have set up the basics, as far as I know in the previous episode. So now basically I'm just going to see if we overlooked some of the stuff that is hidden, and then just extend that a little bit, and then after that we're going to try the same in enforcing mode, and then see where that gets us, and then hopefully at some point we can also leave a Nautilus behind us. So much still to do. So that kind of demotivates. You basically don't see light at the end of the tunnel. That's something that you'll often have with these big S-Linux projects, and it really needs experience so that you can basically tell yourself, yeah, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. There is at some point. You will be at some point be done in to some extent, because actually you're never really done. It's always going to be some maintenance involved, especially with these very fine-grained projects. Okay, so we outsource ABCTS number 912. Order to allow, and last that. So what do we have that might be applicable? Actually, still pretty much. However, we need to really think, because these reads and writes are just Nautilus acting crazy. So these should be, you should be able to actually ignore those. But as for pulse audio, that might actually be needed. And you can basically look at that from a point where it actually, if it actually opens a file, then you can be pretty sure that it actually opens it for a reason. If it's not opening it, then it's just probably just checking whether it could read or write it. But the weird thing is here is that I don't know why, for example, Nautilus would want to either, would want to read the bash config files in the home dir, and I don't know why Nautilus would want to read the pulse audio content. And the pulse audio content is not such big question, because maybe it just uses pulse audio. That will be a very rational explanation. Okay, but if that's true, then why doesn't it try to access the other pulse audio content? Why doesn't it try to execute pulse audio, or stream connect to pulse audio, or debus chat to pulse audio, or access the pulse audio temp files, stuff like that? So really doesn't quite make sense yet. So I think we should try just to to ignore that. But looking at the other things here, for example, we don't have any AFC denials with regard to actually listing the home door, so that's a good sign because we allowed that already. And still no AFC denials with regard to that. We could basically allow the get attribute for cache home. That might be a good idea. Yeah, that might be a good idea. So let's just allow that. Nano my login user TE nout. And another nout. Another nout. And then there's some cache home T stuff here, probably somewhere. Didn't I allow it to actually search cache? Seems I haven't actually allowed it to even search cache. But I'm pretty sure that at some point it's probably going to use cache for something. So probably good idea to just allow it to traverse cache. Alright, so I'm just going to allow that. I'll just do this here. Allow my login user, Nautilus, and then cache home T. Dir, and then just basically search and get attribute. Although it's really still doesn't really make sense because it doesn't actually search it. So that really doesn't, probably isn't a good idea after all. At least not for now. So let's just comment that out as well until we see an actual search of cache home D, T. You see, because it reads and writes the dir, but it gets the attributes of the dir, but it doesn't actually search it. So this is basically so when you basically list a directory, what you get is you basically reach the parent dir for the dir entries, and then basically what you need to do is get the attributes of all the dirs that you're basically listing, so that you can basically list their attributes. So that's basically probably why it wants to get attributes of the cache home dir, so that it also can get the list the attributes of it. And that same probably goes for other stuff that's in the home root. So for example the SSH home dir, but here it actually also wants to search it. The question is, why would it want to search SSH home dir? That might be probably related to Nautilus connection manager in some ways. So that's kind of shitty currently. Let's see if we can force it to do some other stuff. So we have the recent home. Then we have all these options here. So for example, let's just try the properties. And this is the properties, close. Where are the preferences? Those are in this menu, and you have these bookmarks and oh yeah, and you have help. So we need to take care of help, Yelp. So this is a Yelp domain, so we can basically just do that as well. So Nautilus is a Yelp domain. Runs Yelp. But yeah, this is kind of not what I want. The question is, will it crap out if it can't get the attributes if it's trying to lift the list home there? Back in the old, back in the GNOME 2 days, it was really, if it couldn't basically properly list the home there, then it would just basically crap out. Yet, I'm not sure if that's still the case, hopefully not. So now we actually did something useful by actually allowing it to run Yelp with the domain transition, so that's at least something. But other than that, most of these AFC denials that were shown were things that we should probably just don't audit, or at least don't audit and audit access. But we just did write for these don't audit and audit accesses, but it probably also needs to read so let's just do that anyways. Oh, and here we had a read and a write. Oh, actually I did. How did I do that? This should be fine. Single line. This should be fine. Do I still have some coffee left? Yes, I do. Oh, that is nice. So yeah, that's kind of a dilemma. Anyways, let's see if the Yelp transition works. So let's run Yelp. Desktop help. Yelp. Yeah, it's Yelp. So let's have a look. Now we do have some stuff. Oh, ships. We have DVFS once again transitioning. So we need to take care of that before we do anything else. See, because here we have extreme connection to GVFS, so that you know that that is interacting with something that shouldn't even run in that domain. So let's just do the execute no trans then. So grep for execute no trans. Always take care of your transitions first. Recent. So we have another domain. All the way below, and just basically we should be able to copy over some other GVFS stuff. So GVFS the recent. It's the same properties as burn. It's executed by GVFS. So it's what from that in that regard, this is basically the same. Just another GVFS daemon. Sorry. Some people. I was watching the Red Hat Summit. Videos yesterday, and someone really call it. Some people still call it. Really call it daemon instead of daemon, but daemon is EA and daemon is AE. I'm just pretty sure that I'm calling it right if I say daemon, if I call it daemon. Like Daewoo, that car brand in Korea, I guess it is, a Korean car brand. It's Daewoo, not Daewoo, as far as I know. But yeah, of course the sound, it sounds nice if you call it daemon. But it's not a daemon. Daemons are a good thing, not a bad thing. So basically we'll have to log out and go over this once again. Just test it. Again, you need to be patient. Patience and perseverance. Persistence. So yeah, that should be it. Install. Oh, and don't forget to actually restore the context of your GVFS, the recent, because else you're wasting time. And then just basically go over it again, and then you'll see probably some recent related AVC denials. Probably wants to debug again. Now you know the drill. All right. So we have done that. Let's just log off. Update software updates available. Well, we don't support software updates for this restricted user, at least not yet, and probably never will, because it doesn't really make sense, does it? Alright, so we're basically killing the processes right now. Clear the user home door, because some stuff may have been created with the wrong type, since we have some domains running in the some programs running in the wrong domain, like for example that the recent DVFS recent. Clear the login there, lslz temp, and then rmrf temp. Remove that. And then basically see what if you're clean, and if you're clean then well, we're actually not clean probably, since we're running with don't audits, but we're actually clean, that's nice. And then just log in and reproduce this stuff again. And just basically try to test it as much as possible. So we also have these connect server stuff and other Nautilus stuff that we really need to take care of. So if you have that recent stuff, now see if that domain transition actually worked. And here we have recent, so we can basically copy this stuff over. And the remainder looks good, except for this stuff for Nautilus, which is basically outstanding. And we need Nautilus to allow Nautilus to stream connect to GVFS recent, and probably also Debus chat. So yeah, that looks all fine and dandy so far. So let's just do that. Let's go to recent. All the way below. Copy that in. And do the routine. Set up the defaults. So it's actually doing some stuff that they all do. It's using X server. So let's find the block where it's actually doing the X server dance. Where is it? I know Yelp does the X server dance. Here's the X server dance. Oops. Here's the X server dance. So let's paste in the X server dance. And then just remove the X server dance from here. And the funny thing is that doesn't seem to actually read write the inherited generic tempfs file in this from these FC denials. But I'm still going to allow it because, yeah, that's just in the pattern of using X server, so it's probably just required. Alright, so what else does it do? It does that same stuff. It searches user home directories, and that's basically because it wants to search cache data and config. So cache data and config. So we basically go up. First things first. That's basically this stuff here. Take it one step at a time. So that basically takes care of this one and this one. Alright, and then basically it's actually listing data home there's and searching gconf or getting attributes of gconf. And I wonder. These basically can stay the way they are. But this stuff here, let's just keep it simple for now. Because we don't actually know what the heck it's doing there yet. We'll just allow this stuff here. I have a to-do. But yeah, it seems obvious that it's a to-do. And then it's basically connecting to the session bus. And then, yeah, that's to the user session bus. And then we basically also have this where Nautilus connects to recent. Stream connects to recent. Where's Nautilus? Here it is, so we need to add that because that makes sense. Where are the stream connects? So Nautilus actually still uses a lot of stream connects, as you can see. I'm not sure why it still does the old style stream connect when it basically can use dbus for it. But yeah, I guess we need to just accept that maybe it's just still not fully done. But eventually it should probably just be clean and alright. Less far log messages. We know that there's some debugs probably going on. Yeah, actually pretty much, but we need to be careful here. we need to be careful. Really just need to take the last lines. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and I'll just make it 12, maybe 15. Let's make it 15. We need to make sure that we don't take stuff from the older stuff. So we are tailing for the last 15 lines. Do that into outer to allow and then see if it doesn't look too ugly. Tail and yeah, this makes sense. And then add those all the way below. So this is a single direction, the Mylog and Dbus DT, but this is actually bidirectional. Add spy. And this one is bidirectional. And then just we're just basically steadily progressing. We're basically putting our mind to zero and just keep working. That's basically what it's all about. It's the same issue that another guy has, which I've been talking to. I basically know what's involved to do the thing that he's facing, but basically it's just all about working. Just do it, and it's hard. It's a mental thing because you. There's so many unknowns, and you start to think, does it make sense? Am I doing something that makes sense? And then basically, mentally, you're just basically stuck, just like some kind of writer's block, basically the same thing. But if you have experience and you faced it before and you basically conquered it before, then you know that it's just a matter of work. Just work, do your job. Just like any other job. Just do it. You can basically just keep thinking about it, but that doesn't do anything. You need to actually go out and get it. And this, I have the same problem here. I know I'm facing these big issues with Nautilus, and after that, all kinds of other stuff like. You need to be able to run Totem confined. You need to be able to run your web browser confined. You need to be able to run your email confined. And those are just the basics. So yeah, that's basically an hurdle. It's in your mind. It's a mental thing. All right. So let's go back and see what we have. The only way you can basically go around that is to just actually do it. Yeah, these are allowed, I know. So let's just see if I can force something else. So I had Yelp, but Yelp seems to work. And then you have these bookmarks, boom. So that's... Let's create a dir. Oh, actually, yeah, let's create a dir bin. And then create a bookmark. Can I add a bookmark? Can't actually add one. How does that work? Can't I add a bookmark? new window, so it needs to be able to re-execute itself probably. Preferences. Back in the days, you would be able to actually make it list the security contacts, but it seems they removed that. Stupid. It seems, I'm not sure. Okay, let's see if we have anything new. No, not much. I see nothing. Strange that it doesn't re-execute itself. I guess it does it in some other way. But everything else still looks fine. See how that works. I'm just trying to make it do things. Let's just remove that. Why can't I add a bookmark? What's that all about? Enter location. So oh, this is basically this line. So connect to server. This will actually connect to server. So before I do that, I'm going to make sure that I am up to date. Right. Random device gets that get attribute. And we have tr store actually here. So that's interesting. Metadata is interesting. So some of this stuff is interesting. Let's just copy and paste it all and then work our way through it. A lot of this stuff can be ignored, by the way, but so this is for Nautilus. Not this one. Not this one. Let's just paste this all the way below. And remove what we should probably be able to remove. This stuff. Now this is interesting. So it's trying to read metadata, data empty. That should be interesting. This is allowed. This we're going to ignore for now. This random device is probably something that we need to. Take care of. And then these. So now we narrowed it down a little bit. Metadata. Do we have something else that does metadata? Metadata, come on. And then not metadata itself, because that's not. Yeah, does metadata, doesn't he? That's probably just reading metadata, but trying to do this properly, so I'm trying to find some other program that does metadata, and in hopes that I took care of that properly. React basically pulls audio. But this is different, this is the actual ESD file. Metadata, where are you? Not that often used, I think. And this is nautilus. This should be using metadata. What do you think? So many rules. Anyone using metadata? Seems not. Why, that just sucks. I guess everything has a first time. Events uses metadata, doesn't it? But events uses everything that's... Yeah, here we have events. So we can borrow this from events. Okay, go back to Naut. And then go back to our block where we added this stuff. And this is basically that part. And then just change that. So now we can be pretty much assured that we have that stuff right. Get attribute of random. Do we have any access to random? URandom, not random. Okay, so let's leave that in. And then we have track minor config home dir. Do we have anything else for track minor config? Don't do. It's a bit messy. This monster has its fangs in everything. It's a huge thing to confine this one. So yeah, reading it there, but not actually. This is we will ignore this. But this, not. Get attribute. Search. So that it can actually read write the cache. The TR store cache. And that also explains why it needs to traverse cache. And we removed that, didn't we? Yeah, but we need to add that. That explains it. So, where are we? It actually needs to search cache. So, allow my login user Naut. T, cache home T. Because you can't get to TR store cache home T if you can't traverse cache home T. So that makes sense. And then just get attributes and search. It's just basically common sense, especially since it's actually opening the file. If there was some inheritance going on, then maybe, but this is actually opening a file, so that's actually needed. So yeah, right. So we basically took care of that, I guess. Yeah, well, let's just try out the connection connect server bit. So connect to server. Now we have the connect server dialog. So let's have a look. We need a domain transition. If it's executing connect server with a execute no trans, then we know. So it doesn't seem to be actually doing it that way, because I don't see no execute. So this is probably still Nautilus itself, that dialog, or either that or it's doing it via dbus. But doesn't seem so, because there's no AVC denials with regard to. All still looks legit. So no, this is still basically the. Okay, let's try. S no, that doesn't work. This sucks. So we can't actually test that yet. Check the browse. Let's see what we have now. I would need to set up my PKI. Oh, and now we have some new stuff here. And this is probably related with connection ser connect server. So now we have something to go on. So let's do the dance again. Grep execute no trans. Grep execute no trans. And here we have a GVFS network. And there's really a shitload of GVFS apps, and we actually need to do them all. Or at least if we want the functionality. Okay, T. Patience and perseverance, just do it, don't cry. Give you a fast network. It's the same properties as any other GVFS daemon, well, except then the main one. It's actually executed by GVFSD, which is basically the main hub, the main gateway. It's what executes all these GVFS childs, or yeah, minions, so to speak. GVFSD is GVFSD boss. Make sure that you restore combat stuff again. Okay, we have What's wrong with that? Unknown type, GGSSD network. Thought that looks fine. Must be some other typo. Oh, yeah. I'll be damned. Oh man, what a mess. I had my hat somewhere else when I typed that. Let's hope I didn't make any other similar mistakes. And then just restore on this file or this location. And then just start all over again. Keep testing until you're pretty sure that you have every functionality touched on. Okay, log off. Remove stuff. So far it didn't really actually create much. We could actually also still this far log messages. There's also debugs going on, but we need to be careful with debugs, by the way. And there's not much debugs going on at all, so that's fine. But yeah, probably network is going to want to debug chat, I guess. That would make sense. Kill all, clear, you know it. LSLZ temp. RMRF temp. Alright, so we took care of that. Our search. And we're at 9:58, 30 minutes later. Time goes fast when you're having fun. Oh, actually, you forgot to remove that binder. I should do that so that I can check trash, because trash functionality, I need to test that as well. So let's just remove the put this to trash, move to trash. Then we at least have some trash stuff. So let's deal with that first, because that's going to be, you have to create probably a file or create a dir. Looks fine. Then we have session doing the login, the inhibit, and we need to allow that. First things first. The session. And do we have some inhibit related stuff here already? That way, so let's paste that in. Sim. System D in sessions, but we don't have inherit. It's writing a FIFO file, that, so that's yeah, that's something happens a lot when Dbus is involved. That stuff writes to systemd, yeah, systemd FIFO files. Here we have trash. I wanna see what it's actually doing here. Because that's weird that it doesn't actually create. Back in the days, it used to, yeah, here it actually does that. Here it actually, and this is basically what's creating that trash, and then this is what's reading it. So that's how that works. So let's have a look at that. Let's just grab Nautilus and grab create. Basically, what it does is it's actually moving the dir to another trash dir, and then actually that's what I think it does. Grab create. Trash info. So it's here, it's that creating a trash there. So we need to just take care of that. We need to basically protect trash. So trash is in data home. So let's just ls all z home my login user local share, and then there's a trash there somewhere. Yeah, trash. So let's just take care of that trash data on the. Alright. So file context file. And then user local share and then trash. Trash. Save that. So we have trash data home tree, and that's basically for Nautilus. So let's naut and then go up down, and let's just put this here. Type trash data home tree and copy this over. And trash data home tree, it's the same idea. And then, yeah, it's creating a file. So basically, we can press other data home tree related stuff. There isn't actually any messy. So Nautilus has a data home there, but it doesn't actually. Oh, here it is. Yeah, here it is. This is it. So we can basically ignore that and just allow this. Because we already have that, so that would be duplicate. And then it's trash data empty. And here we have that transition. A lot of stuff to do. And then we have actually, and I'll just copy this over here. It's creating a file, and then we have basically trash reading that file. But oops, coughing again, must be the weather. Oh, trash data home tree. And this is with a capital T. Yeah. So let's just grab dot empty. Let's see what happens here. So what you get here is Nautilus is creating that stupid file, bin trash info in the trash there, which is basically now classified properly. And this gets attribute, does all kinds of things, rename stuff, rename the file. Oh, we don't have that, so I want to an unlink file. So let's just add it to allow that and just adjust that a little bit. So with regard to this, and that basically lets also look. So it's basically also the what is it? Now where's that other piece of stuff? Trash. It's also reading that file. So basically, let's just copy this all over. It's all with regard to that stupid trash. So type enforcement file. Let's first go to Node. Or not. And place it in for now, for just to compare it a little bit. So here we have the remove name and create, and we have to create, but we don't have to remove name. Remove name, and then it also does a lot of stuff here. And since write create open, write create open, so we can basically just replace that. Paste that in, so that's that, and then basically we're having to deal with this trash, and this is basically copy that over. Trash is all the way below, and then paste that in. Oh, not here. Trash. Where's my trash? Here's trash. And then we basically put that in here because it's related. It's related. So we're having here a get attribute. Actually, it's opening a dir. Get attribute. Search. Then it's probably reading it. And that's just actually trash on data empty. And the same as this is also trash data empty. So this should be suffice. It's just basically listing it, listing the dir and its contents, and reading its contents. And since it's just actually trash, I'll just allow that. Okay, so that's actually, let's just then, oh wait, we're pretty much clean, and let's, oh man, that took a long time. Actually delete that file because we hadn't done that yet. Empty trash. It's emptying it. Now so this is all about just basically moving references, not doing it with the actual file, this basically making the making a display, but eventually the file will still use a home T. This is the dir there, the binder, sorry, that we removed. So this was all just display stuff. And this actually, yeah, this is actually trash data home T. We can look that up. So that works in really weird ways. See, that's still that stupid. Oh, actually, not quite. But no, that's it. It is. It is. Yeah, it is. All right, back. This is pretty interesting stuff in my view. DVFS dtrash. It's pretty interesting in my view. So let's just place this in here for now. So this actually. Can be extended. And that entity is actually a link. So this is that. Then you have this metadata home stuff. And as far as I can remember, there was this and a dir search. And then here we have the actual deletion of question is how how do we deal with this? You see, it's probably a good idea to allow the user to manage only generic content. We actually have a reparent here, so I probably need to require that class dir reparent. This is the first time. I think we use that. So yeah, this is just for dir, but eventually you'll probably need to do that for other, at least some stuff for other types of stuff. So yeah, do we have any new DBus related stuff? Seems to have not connected to the session bus, but we do have some. Metadata is actually chatting to trash. So that's about 10 or 15 is fine if we still have that in the buffer recently. Might as well just type it out. So this is basically, I'll just add that that's at trash. GVFS FSD trash. Because else it's trash is so empty. And then this is two-way, bi-directional. Trash is chatting to metadata. Yeah. All right. Damn. This Nautilus stuff is pretty complex. And really, you need to have a vision to, at least that's in my view. You really need to have a plan and vision if you want to actually confine that, because else you're going to make all kinds of decisions that you later just think that doesn't really make sense or that. And I have really this idea of, yeah, I want this user to use the file browser to actually manage content, but only content in its home there, and only generic content in there. Because that makes sense. This config content is basically content of the user application, not of the user itself. The generic user content is content that the user creates or programs create really on behalf of the user. So we really make a distinction here in this design that we have generic user content, content that is by the user, for the user, or we have private home content types, which is basically not by the user, not by the user, but for the user, in the sense that it's needed for the user applications, its configuration and cache data and data for the application. So that's basically the distinction that I'm trying to make. So the user can actually manage stuff, but only generic stuff. I don't want him to be able to delete, for example, configuration data. I'm just expecting that the program, let's just say it the following way. If the user wants to actually change a user confined user application configuration data, then he should do so not directly by editing the file, but rather by opening that program and telling that program to do it itself, rather than doing it directly. That's basically how I hope that it's going to work, and hope that there's no corruption going on. But I never had to manually edit a lot of this stuff, except that, for example, I sometimes want to use the local share applications there to add a custom desktop file, for example. So we should eventually, if we ever get to that point, we should give that a private type, the local share applications there, and then just allow the user to actually create content in there so that he can actually create its own desktop file. You see, that's one of those exemptions, so to speak. But for all this other stuff, I never had to change the recently used file manually. That's not something you should be doing, I guess. So why give him access? Why give a user access to that? That's only access permissions. And the idea of confining the desktop is that you get rid of access permissions. If you don't need to do something, then just don't do something. That's the idea of this project, at least of my. This is the goal that I'm trying to achieve. I'm just trying to basically map out the whole desktop. That's why I'm doing all this stuff. That's why I'm giving everything a private type. Not because it necessarily makes sense from a security perspective, but I just want to start by mapping out all these programs, see what they actually do and who owns what. And then later I can basically decide, okay, well, that makes sense to give all this stuff a private type. Let's just merge them in. Let's just merge domains that have similar properties, and that it doesn't really make sense to keep them separate. But that's just something for later. I'm just trying to basically map it out, give myself a roadmap of how all these applications operate and interact with each other, And then later, at some later point, I can just make informed decisions about how to basically actually achieve some really security goals, and also, yeah, make stuff not overly complex. But now, currently, right now, I'm just making sure that there's no access permissions. So that's basically it. So, well, that's an important aspect of policy writing, in my view, that you basically have a goal before you start doing stuff. If you just do stuff and you don't actually know what you're doing, then yeah, that's not good. So I do have a goal, although the goal doesn't necessarily make sense. Log out, and let's get this trash there settled properly. From a security perspective, it doesn't really, it's just basically overdoing it. But this is all documented, so you also need to keep that in mind, that I just also do this to just document stuff. I'm recording all this stuff, so that at a later point, if someone actually wants to confine the desktop efficiently and quickly, that he can basically look at these videos and learn from the stuff that I mapped, and then make a decision based on what he sees, although you shouldn't actually do that either, but it could help. So let's kill. I'm just trying to learn here, basically. I'm just trying to learn. Temp. I don't have no deadlines. I don't have no boss looking over my shoulder. I'm just sitting here and I'm just wondering, how does this desktop work? What does what? What owns what? And who needs what? And where can I basically confine? Where can I? What can I control? That's basically what I'm trying to do here. Are we clean? And that's what's interesting about this. And especially since I also did GNOME 2, I can basically compare that to how GNOME 2 did things and how this is doing things. Really learned a lot from that experience. And I'm learning a lot from this experience as well. And that's basically what gives me vision and inspiration. All right, so we were clean, we logged in, so we just need to do some stuff and then just but also not get ahead of ourselves, step by step. But this looks clean so far. Don't see anything related to, oh, I didn't actually start it yet. Nautilus. All right, so Nautilus, where are you? GFS, Demon Shell. These are all things that I took care of. I still know. Oh, yeah, here's Nautilus. So we're basically back to where we were before. Let's just do things. Created their tests this time. Remove the door. Remove trash. With regard to trash, everything seems to be going smoothly so far. And this is only a dir, so I haven't actually tested deleting a file yet. But I guess I could. Let's just do that. Open up a shell. And then just touch. Hello? Close the shell. Now we have the hello file. Remove it. Look at trash. And then empty. Oh, and need and restore. We also probably need to be able to restore it. Stuff like that. So much testing to involved. We need to test every single functionality, basically. So this desession, all kinds of stuff that's not related. Here we have some stuff. And here we have, this can be ignored. So this is a trash. GVFSD trash. So where do we have the stuff related to that? Oh yeah, here we have some stuff related. Let's paste it in for a while here. So this XDG config, that makes sense. So we need to basically add that where it belongs. And this basically also makes sense. Config, but it doesn't actually. Not actually allowed to search config yet. So let's paste this in here. Remove this. So basically to do this you need to allow copy. Config home t, and do you know what I'm doing here? To be able to read this XDG config home file, you need to be able to traverse config home, and since that doesn't, it wasn't done here yet, I think, we just allow it to read it, actually traverse it. Makes sense to me. Let's far look messages. We have a dbus related stuff. Metadata. Check to Nautilus. Actually. So we have basically two things to take care of, and I think I already took care of trash with regard to GVFSD and out, so just need to take care of this one. First, let's have a look. GVFSD trash with regard to Debus chatting. No, actually not. Need to take care of that as well. First do Nautilus. Where are my Debus chats at Nautilus? Actually, I haven't done any so far, have I? Seems not. Weird. Would have expected that. Anyways, paste it in. So here we have all this stuff here. So we need to take care of that. Let's start above. This is bi-directional. This knob, this isn't bi-directional. It's acquiring session on the user session bus. This is all bi-directional. Oh, this isn't required, but so it's Debus chatting with a lot of GVFSD components. So you could basically at some point just restrict some communications and then thereby preventing stuff. So for example, if you don't want to use it to delete something, then you might be able to do that by just preventing Nautilus chat to trash. Although I doubt that that will work smoothly, because since Nautilus itself does a lot of stuff related to trash. Now we need to take care of trash, and we already have some trash stuff. Let's just copy it over and then just only use what we need. GVFSD trash. So it already did chat to something, the metadata, but it actually wasn't chatting to the user session bus. So that's something that we need to, and we have taken care of this one here of Nautilus, because we just allowed Nautilus to chat to trash, so that's bi-directional, so that's taken care of. So that's basically, and this is single way, and this is bi-directional. So that's basically all. All right. All right. What else do we have for functionality? And actually, this is what a file browser does, doesn't it? Bookmark this location. Oh! All right. So let's go to home and then create a new folder, bin. And that's where the bookmark this location was. And here you have. And I'll just go to bin and then bookmark this location. And now I have a bookmark. So let's see what is related with regard to that at 10:35. I was looking at that. I was wondering how the hell am I supposed to create a bookmark. doesn't actually need anything for that. And this is that network stuff. Browse the network. Bang. And now GVFSD is trying to do stuff again. So we have various stuff here. We have this thing here. And then we also have GVFS executing another thing, which actually connects to the network. So yeah, keeps going and going and going this. So this is network related, GVFSD network. Let's just paste this in, and first things first, keep you cool, don't panic. So we have this deconf stuff, this deconf temp stuff, so we can basically just copy that over from something else that does the deconf temp here. And that's GVFSD network. Then remove these, and this one. We have deconf. Well, we can also use that. Something that actually does the deconf dance. This does the deconf dance. It just keeps going and going and going and going. And you just need to work. Work, 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 work. Don't think too much about all that stuff. Just keep going, going, going. And because else you'll never. And this is a bug. Yep. See, that's nice. You'll actually it's be able to find your own bug. So basically what it says here, it wants to make the GVFS the network exact file and entry point to the network domain. So I'm just figuring shit, I should already have that. So I'm now looking at it and it says make the GVFS the recent domain. Make the GVFS network exactly an entry point to the recent domain. So that makes sense. That's a bug, an overlook, and a cut and paste error, basically. So that can be removed as well. Now, to be able to get to config to actually read those deconf config home t files, we need to basically search user home directories. So basically this. And then you have here, it's searching cache. Now that's fine. But I'm not sure why it's searching cache yet, but get attribute search and allow that. And then you have this user home dir search, but that we already allowed because yeah, it needs to search stuff to be able to Now this here is not legit. Probably. We can't take any risks. So I'm not sure if I explained that to you already, but when you're confining the desktop, basically what you need to focus on is that your confined applications don't interact with or operate with the user domain. And this is the user session bus. And basically, this is probably just a process running. So if you looked at the previous AVC denials, then you saw that the session debus session bus ran a program and we're in permissive mode, so we allowed that. So this is not actually the user bus that it's trying to connect to. This is actually some program that we should confine. So always be careful when your confined application tries to interact with something user related, because nothing should be running in the user domain. And let me tell you that applications don't connect to the user session bus, because the user doesn't have a session bus service. So that doesn't make sense. So that's why I just know that this is not legit. And also with the previous knowledge that I have from these AVC denials here, because I know that here the session, oh, there's actually GVFSD, so that doesn't make sense. So maybe it actually is not related, but still, I'm not going to take any chances. I don't understand why actually I do understand why I'm going to do it anyways. So that's just one stupid argument of me, but still you need to be careful. But yeah, it's trying to get session, it's trying to get service on the session bus, so it is legit. So yeah, you need to be careful, but you need to be able to actually find the reason behind it. But you'll see that network is going to want to chat later, so it makes sense. I'm just trying to be careful here, because I know that we're dealing with stuff. This is actually what I'm worried about. Why? Because here we have GVFS running a generic file, and maybe it's just debus chatting to this program, whatever this program is, and we're going to figure that out now. And this is it, SMB browse. So maybe network was just chatting to SMB browse, but since SMB browse ran in the GFSD domain, it was trying to stream connect to the GFSD domain. But that's not the actual what happened, what we want to happen, because we want to confine this and then allow it to chat to GFSD SMB browse, not to GFSD. So yeah. Maybe you know you won't understand what I'm saying right now, but hopefully you do, because this is very important in my view. Always take care of transitions first. That's basically what it boils down to. So I'm actually doing it wrong. I'm actually trying to take a shortcut here. I should just taking care of this first before I added these rules with regard to network. That's basically what you need to. But yeah, you want to hurry, and then you're just doing stuff that you basically just shouldn't do. But it's fortunate that I at least know the issues, so that I can basically keep that in mind. that's basically why I'm not falling for that trick. Okay. DFS the SMB browse. So new domain for SMB browse. It was running this SMB browse domain without a domain transition. And then our network, GVSD network, was trying to stream connect to GVSD, but that was actually GVSD SMB browse, but it in the wrong domain. And if you allow that, then you'll allow something that you don't need to allow. Because it doesn't need to stream connect to GVSD, it needs to stream connect to GVSD SMB browse. And if you would have taken care of domain transitions before you do anything else, then you wouldn't have this problem, because you wouldn't just look at even at that rule for stream connect. You just say, okay, domain transition, so I'm going to take care of that first, and then I'm going to look at new AFC DNS and decide again, but not, I'm not going to do that now. But yeah, since I'm not what I'm since I'm saying do what I say but not say as I do, or whatever the hell that do as I say but not say as I do, or blah blah. Anyways, restore cons. Make first. Oh yeah, do as I say, not as I do. As my job. Do as I say, not as I do. Restore con. So now we just need to go all over this stuff again. The Windows network. We don't have a Windows network. We don't do Windows. Windows sucks. Windows doesn't provide this flexibility that we have here. The power. This is just only type enforcement and a little bit of role-based access control. But we have like five security models to our disposal. Five. So we can do with this stuff much more powerful if we'd like to. We could implement user-based access control for isolation. We could implement multi-category security or multi-level security on top of this stuff. Role-based access control to basically create different roles. All kinds of neat stuff. And I don't think Windows provides that flexibility, at least not to this to this level. That's what I think. I have to admit that I'm not sure. I know in the past I played a little bit with group policy stuff in Windows, But that was all just predefined, just like GNOME dconf or G settings. It's also, yeah, it's nice, but it's all fixed. You can't really make your own decisions. You have a few things to choose from, and if it's not in the list, then you're just basically screwed. Oops. But with SE Linux, you can make your own list, make your own decisions. Flexibility, configurability. That's the difference. And that's what makes this so powerful. And that what makes it a better desktop, especially in the corporate environment. If you want to have like front office desktops, that are just basically limited, then yeah, that's just great. You can basically create these profiles and implement them. But yeah, that requires that you, that costs money, because yeah, I've been spending like almost a week or 2 weeks on this stuff already, and I haven't accomplished much yet. And it requires that the vision, that you know what you can do and that you also can implement it. So yeah, it's easier said than done, but at least you have the power to do it if you just invest enough. With proprietary software, you don't even have a choice. And open source software gives you that choice, and it gives you an opportunity to actually share a goal with others and work towards achieving that goal, which makes achieving the goal much easier, because you can't do everything on your own all the time. All right, so let's create a dir. Well, let's first take care of, see if how this browse network stuff pans out. So many processes, doing so many stuff, so much stuff. It's actually, after all, it's actually still SIM connected to GVFSD and not GVFS Sprout. But you can't, still not, no, that's not true. It's actually running another binary, so we're shit. It's like a never ending story, this. So let's grab execute node runs and see what the hell it's running now. Damn. Never ending story, this. DNS SD. Alright, so we have another one. Crying out loud. So now I'm going to do it right. Actually, now I'm also going to do it wrong this time, but I'll first take care of this stuff. Shit. The amount of GVFS programs. DNS SD. It's like a whole list of these. But yeah, these do provide some nice flexibility if you can find those. Could, I'm not saying it definitely, but they might allow you, by confining this, it might allow you some nice options later on. I'm going to have a quick look at the IRC channel. SMB browse. Need to take care of that as well. But yeah, could be a nice business plan to basically do some consulting and consult companies on how they can implement SE Linux in environments like these, where you basically, for example, if you have call centers with Linux desktops or something like that, where you can basically just on a large scale lock desktop sessions down in a tailor-made fashion, but just basically consult at provide consulting services, and then also add a basically implementation department or something like that. Something like that would be nice. There might actually be some business there. So yeah, I added this, and now before I'm going to do anything else, I'm going to basically just build this and restore con that file, because else I'm going to forget to restore con it. Oops, that's not. I need to install it first, and then restore con this file. So in this chapter, there are really some good examples in this chapter, I think. Especially with regard to what I've been preaching all along. Make sure that you do your transitions first. Because I'm actually almost falling for my own mistake, and that's funny, actually. Because I keep bumping on these where it's trying to connect to GVFSD, but deep in my heart, my guts tell me this is not right. This might not be right, and I hope eventually I will be able to show you that it wasn't right after all to add this rule. That would be a great lesson. That would be well. We can actually take care of this here, because this is already has already transitioned and it doesn't actually execute anything anymore. So we could we can already implement this stuff here. Let's see what else we have just quickly. So this GVFS stuff, we can't do that any yet. And here we have Nautilus stream connecting to GVFS network. We can also take care of that. So we can take care of that. So let's do that. Where is it stream connected to other stuff here? And it's also stream connecting to GVFSD network. And there we have basically these rules with regard to SMB browse, I guess it was, wasn't it? Yeah. So SMB browse actually connects to the network. So it doesn't actually show which port. But that might be related to UDP. So let's just take care of the obvious stuff first, like deconf tempty. See, it's actually doing that deconf tempty dance, like all of them do, and also the deconf homepty dance. Predictable. Predictable. We're just working through all these issues. And then it's also doing the deconf stuff, and we can also add that just in. Same as network, basically. But it doesn't mess with cache, seems so far. So this app actually messes with the network. Deconfine, we can remove that. It's also messing with session stuff, session bus, user session bus, and it's the DNS name resolving, and then it's node binding UDP, so it's actually doing some UDP stuff, and then you have var t dir get attribute, so it's probably searching get attribute search. I don't have Samba set up, so I don't really know. And this is user ID search, it's also allowed already. So yeah, we need to just for now accept the way it is. Okay, make. I'm going to take a break soon, because we have some unknown type. And that's right, because it's the first time that we actually do a node bind. Probably also need to require that. So let's go ahead and do that where it's actually require. So type node t. It's a generic node. And I'll just do this the way this way. And then class UDP socket node bind. And that's probably Sebas PMing me. He is on holidays. So, and he likes to chat. But I have work to do. Anyways, if once this is built, I'm going to take a break anyways. Well, of course, it's easier said than done. So type Samba etct. And then it's probably Samba var t as well. Oh Christ. Set ops, not a find, get attribute, right. I'm just going to take them all. So yeah, it's doing stuff that it normally doesn't do. Or that it normally doesn't do, that's bullshit. That we haven't yet needed. That we haven't needed yet, but we're needing it now. So we're requiring it. So yeah. Save this. Yeah, suppose. Oh man, he's so social and he wants to chat. About how great Germany is and stuff like that, and that's all good, but I have some work to do as well. So let's quit logout. and then clean up, and then I'll take a break. It's hanging. This must be the fifth time again. Or the sixth. Kill all my login user, clear. That's all Z, temp, RM, RF, temp. LS. All Z, home login, my login user, and then RM dir. All right, so we're back to square zero. I'm going to take a break right now, so see you later.